And you can see, take a look at what happens in verse 17. There were many in the assembly who had not sanctified themselves. They didn't take a bath. They didn't wash themselves properly before they entered the temple, which was not according to the law. Therefore, the Levites had charge of the slaughter of the Passover lambs for everyone who was not clean to sanctify them to the Lord. Multitude of the people, many from Ephraim, Manasseh, Issachar, and Zebulun, all in Israel, had not cleansed themselves. Yet they ate the Passover contrary to what was written. But listen to this. But Hezekiah prayed for them, saying, "May the good Lord provide atonement for everyone." Do you see the heart of the leadership here? Do you see the heart of Hezekiah? He wasn't going to tear them apart because, hey, you came in there and you can't eat that. No, instead, he prayed that the Lord would forgive them. He prayed for atonement for them. You know what God did? He healed them. Isn't that awesome? That's what God does. It isn't about going out and making people come somewhere so that they can get straightened out and we'll straighten them out good. No. It's about calling people to come to the Lord, leading them to Him. My definition of evangelism: declare and direct. Declare who God is and direct others to Him. He'll take care of the rest. He will take care of the rest. Isn't that an old song? Yeah, I thought so. And look at verse 21. So the children of Israel who were present at Jerusalem kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days with great gladness. The Levites and the priests praised the Lord day by day, singing to the Lord accompanied by loud instruments. Can you imagine having a church service for 7 days? And they want to be there? It's not like, oh man, we got 4 more days to go. No, they want to be there. You know why I know that? Thank you. Because they asked if they could stay another 7 days. So they stayed for another 7 days. They stayed for 2 weeks. A 2-week service. Awesome. Just continually praising. And continually seeing the hand of the Lord move. But look at this as well. Verse 22. Hezekiah gave encouragement to all the Levites who taught the good knowledge of the Lord. You see, this wasn't worship independent of the truth of the Scriptures. I've read most of this book. It's called Revival and Revivalism. It's a very interesting book. And those of you who are students of the great revivals of the early 18th century, the 1700s, in the early 1800s here in America, I know there was a great move. It's called the Great Awakening, another great term for revivalism, for revival. But there's something that happened, and let me find the right spot here I wanted to share with you. It says, many of the writers on revival before the 1870s spoke very differently. The preachers and authors who had known the second Great Awakening left a testimony which can never be harmonized with the thinking of most of the later revival writers. So what happened was they came up with the idea that there were two different kinds of revival. There was the old kind, which just came when the Lord determined it. Then there's the new kind, which we can make happen. And that's the term that this guy uses for revivalism. And what happens in that is it gets separated from biblical knowledge. It gets separated from a biblical example, from a biblical model of what revival is, as we are looking at here in 2 Chronicles. And one of the things that happens in that is that it gets separated from the Word of God and starts being, well, this amazing thing happened. Hey, that amazing thing happened. Hey, let's see if we can get that amazing thing to happen again. And the focus becomes on the thing instead of on the Lord. The whole ethos has changed, he said. The older generation, while prizing the work of the Spirit of God in history, never gave their interest in that work priority over the work of the same Spirit in indicting the truth in Scripture. For God works in accordance with His Word. Without Scripture, there is no sword of the Spirit. The test whether experience is of the Spirit of God or of another spirit is whether or not it brings greater understanding of the Bible and a closer obedience to it. Too often, there have been Holy Ghost parties. And these guys are talking about Holy Ghost parties back in the mid-1800s. There have been some in the 1900s. There's probably some going on right now somewhere in the world. All about the excitement and not about the Lord. True revival is about the Lord, and it brings us to a knowledge of and obedience to the Word of God. And here we see they're teaching. The Levites are teaching the good knowledge of the Lord. It's not just it's a big party. They're teaching. And the final thing I want to point out to you is in just one verse, verse 30 or verse 1 of chapter 31. It says, "Now when all this was finished, all Israel who were present went out to the cities of Judah and broke the sacred pillars in pieces." These are the pagan sacred pillars. "And cut down the wooden images and threw down the high places and the altars from all Judah and Benjamin and Ephraim and Manasseh." So that's actually outside of Judah. "Until they had utterly destroyed them all, then all the children of Israel returned to their own cities, each man to his own possession." The fourth thing that is a characteristic of genuine revival is fruit that lasts. It lasts after that exciting move and awareness of God is gone. It lasts. It's not just a wonderful experience for a moment, and man, I wish we could get back to that thing that happened last week or last year or last decade. It is, man, this has changed my life, and there is fruit that lasts.